Good morning, everyone. We want to welcome you to the house of the Lord this morning. We're certainly glad that you're here. If you hear me kind of sniffing and snorting a little bit, I don't have the plague or anything like that. Allergy season has hit. Who are my fellow allergy sufferers? Man, you know, this week has been a baddie. And so we're hoping that it's going to, my meds and everything are going to take effect here, but I'm going to need your help singing. We're all going to sing out good and loud this morning. I'm looking forward to the time of worship that we're going to have. So as we begin, let's open with a word of prayer. Heavenly Father, we pause and acknowledge your goodness. We're grateful for this opportunity that we have as your people to gather in this place. And we very much invite your presence, Lord. We want you to meet us where we are. We want to be so aware of you this morning. And I just pray that as we worship and attempt to be a blessing to you, we anticipate greatly, Lord, that you would just bless our hearts. We give you thanks, praise, and glory in Jesus' name. Amen. I'm going to invite you to stand, and we're going to sing together, Open Up the Heavens. today. We're gathered in your name, calling out to you. Your glory like a fire, awakening desire, will burn our hearts with truth. You're the reason we're here. You're the reason we're singing. Open up the heavens, we want to see you. Open up the floodgates, a mighty river flowing from your heart, filling every part of our praise. Your presence in this place, your glory on our face, we're looking to the sky. Descending like a cloud, you're standing with us now, Lord, unveil our eyes. You're the reason we're here, you're the reason we're singing. Open up the heavens, we want to see you. Open up the floodgates, a mighty river flowing from your heart, filling every part of our praise. Open up the heavens, we want to see you. Open up the floodgates, a mighty river flowing from your heart, filling every part of our praise. Show us your glory. Show us your power. Show us your glory, Lord. Sing that again. Show us your glory. And show us your power. Show us your glory, Lord. Show us your glory. And show us your power. And show us your glory, Lord. Yeah, open up the heavens. We want to see you. Open up the floodgates. A mighty river flowing from your heart, filling every part of our praise. Yeah, open up the heavens. We want to see you. Open up the floodgates. A mighty river flowing from your heart, filling every part of our praise.
Amen. Well, we're going to continue to acknowledge the Lord this morning. You know, Christians ought to be the most joyful people in the world. And I don't mean like that painted on, like fake happy type of thing. I mean having real joy. You know, you've heard me say this before. Sometimes you meet somebody and they almost have that attitude of like, you know, I've been a Christian for 30 years and it's been great. And you kind of want to say, you should tell your face, you know? There should be joy in the house of the Lord. And we're going to sing that this morning. There'll be joy in the house of the Lord. We worship the God who was. We worship the God who is. We worship the God who evermore will be. He opened the prison doors. He parted the raging sea. My God, He holds the victory. There's joy in the house of the Lord. There's joy in the house of the Lord today. We won't be quiet. We shout out your praise. There's joy in the house of the Lord. Our God is surely in this place. We won't be quiet. We shout out your praise. Oh, We sing to the God who heals. We sing to the God who saves. We sing to the God who always makes a way. 'Cause he hung up on that cross, then he rose up from that grave. My God's still rolling stones away. And there's joy in the house of the Lord. There's joy in the house of the Lord today. And we won't be quiet. We shout out your praise. There's joy in the house of the Lord. Our God is surely in this place. We won't be quiet. We shout out your praise. 'Cause we were the beggars, and now we're royalty. We were the prisoners, now we're running free. We are forgiven, accepted, redeemed by his grace. Let the house of the Lord sing praise. Sing that again. 'Cause we were the beggars, and now we're royalty. We were the prisoners, and now we're running free. We are forgiven, accepted, redeemed by his grace. Let the house of the Lord sing praise. There's joy in the house of the Lord. There's joy in the house of the Lord today. We won't be quiet. We shout out your praise. There's joy in the house of the Lord. Our God is surely in this place. We won't be quiet. We shout out your praise. There's joy in the house of the Lord. There's joy in the house of the Lord today. And we won't be quiet. We shout out your praise. There's joy in the house of the Lord. Our God is surely in this place. We won't be quiet. We shout out your praise.
Well, we serve a great God, and I say so often, we want to be reminded in this time of praise and worship that this isn't just getting together to sing, you know, nice songs that kind of help us feel better. They're songs of proclamation of who our God is, what he's done, and what he means to us. And as a result, we also make proclamations of who we are as a people who belong to him. And so even as we continue to worship this morning, as we prepare to hear from God's word, and we sing a song like, Great is Thy Faithfulness, let's be reminded this morning that he's been faithful before, he's been faithful throughout history, and he'll be faithful again. And so maybe you come in this morning and, you know, things aren't, you know, just, they're not everything that you wish they would be. Maybe if you're being honest, they're just not going that great. And it can seem like God is far away. It can seem like he's distant. Let's be reminded that between the spring and the harvest is that word time. And that can be a hard part. But God isn't on vacation. He doesn't sleep. He doesn't slumber. He's still working. And his faithfulness is still true. Let's sing.
Great is thy faithfulness, O God my Father. There is no shadow of turning with thee. Thou changest not, thy compassions they fail not. As thou hast been, thou forever will be. Summer and winter and springtime and harvest, sun, moon, and stars in their courses above, join with all nature in manifold witness to thy great faithfulness, mercy, and love.
Beginning to end.
Beginning to end, my life is
something I know. Great, great is your faithfulness. Oh, great, great is your faithfulness.
Pardon for sin and a peace that endureth. Thine own dear presence to cheer and to guide. Strength for today and bright hope for tomorrow. Blessings all mine with 10,000 beside. Beginning to end, my life.
Great is thy faithfulness, great is thy faithfulness. Morning by morning, new mercies I see. All I have needed, thy hand has provided. Great is thy faithfulness, Lord, unto me.
Let's pray together. Our great God and Heavenly Father, what we proclaim about you is true. Great are you. Great is your name to be praised. Great is your faithfulness. Great is your forgiveness. Great is your compassion. And great are you, Lord. I pray that as we make these statements of faith this morning, Lord, that we would preach to our own hearts, that we would be reminded of who you are, that we would be reminded of who we are in you, that your faithfulness is so great, and so should our joy be. Great is your forgiveness, and so should our praise be. And I just pray, Lord, that as a result of who you are, that we would live lives that others would see and not be able to help but give thanks to the God who provides, the God who knows, the God who heals, the great God that we serve. And so, Lord, we just commit this day and the days ahead to you. Even this time of worship, we give you all praise, all glory, all honor and power. Be to our Lord Jesus Christ. For it is in the name of Jesus that we pray. Amen. You can be seated.
Well, it is good to be together with you once again. It's always wonderful to be with God's people on a Sunday morning, to be able to gather in a place like this without fear, to be able to get here easily, and it's just something we don't want to take for granted. Know that powerful things happen when God's people get together to worship and to pray, and so we're going to do that this morning. Want to continue to thank you for the donations that have come in for the food bank, for that, we are grateful. The need is so significant right now. And so anytime that we can provide for that, and I know that They're starting to get to know us in there. I told you last week that you know, Bob was in, they go, "Ha, here comes the church." And I was, man, I love that phraseology. May it be said of us because of how we live, that here comes the church. That was just such, I've been thinking about that all week. So again, if you have the ability, and in some cases the memory, to be able to bring that in, that would be wonderful. With that all being said, do any of you have any prayer requests or thanksgiving or anything of the like that you'd like to bring before one another this morning? Anything at all? Absolutely, absolutely. So some that are battling sickness, it's that, you know, it can be just that stage of life or time of year. So anybody that's battling that, those connected to Bobby, we'll certainly pray for them this morning. Yes, so we're always grateful for people to be landing and say, like, over this, long season where people were away for a long time. And, you know, Juan has mentioned this a few weeks. We ought to be praying for revival here. We ought to be praying for God to, you know, bring more people to us, and we ought to be praying for God to prepare us. This is a part we often leave out. We ought to be praying for God to prepare us to receive them, so that when they land here, we don't go, "Oh my goodness, what do we do?" We're ready with people, and that is a good word. Sorry?
Handshakes and smiles are
free. Handshakes and smiles, and hugs if you'll let me get a hold of you. I'm telling you, man. I'm telling you. I heard somebody say no, but that was a joke. Oh, it's Troy. Yeah, never mind. No, it's fine. He can stay away from me. That's fine. And look, if anybody else does too, just put a hand up. Like, he'll go away. He looks tough, but he's not. Oh, man. I get chasing rabbits now. Okay, now I'm back. Now I'm back. Anything else that we could be praying for or rejoicing about this morning? Anything at all? Okay. Okay. Absolutely. Okay, on May 8th. So we'll be praying for safe travel, for good results, and just what's great for Elliot there. And we're super glad to see him again, too, for sure. For sure. Anything else this morning? Okay. If that be all, then we'll have a time of silent prayer, and I'll close our prayer time this morning. Our great God and Heavenly Father, we approach you once again and give you thanks. We're so grateful to be able to be in a place like this, Lord, to be able to worship together, to gather as believers. We know this building is just a structure. It's just where the church has chosen to meet. And we're grateful for that. Pray, Lord, that as we gather here today, that the worship that we bring before you would be acceptable. As our attempt to bless you returns to us, Lord, we give you thanks, we give you praise, and we give you all glory that you are the God of the universe, you're the creator of the earth, you're the author of this life, the sustainer of our faith. And we have so much to thank you for, Lord. For you have blessed us in abundance, and yet you know the concerns we have. Pray that you'd be with with Elliot as he travels to the IWK. I just pray for really good results there, Lord. And I pray that you be with the Clark family as they travel. I pray that despite the circumstances, Lord, that perhaps even that little journey could just be a time of refreshing for them. That they would just feel your peace and feel your presence. Lord, you know the situations here that we've been praying for, battling illnesses, battling difficult situations. You know those that have been spoken. You know those that have not been. And ask that you be with both. Lord, you know our circumstances. You know our hearts more deeply than we even understand it ourselves. And so I pray, Lord, that you would work in such a way that it is so evident that we see it in our own lives. I pray that you would work in such a way, Lord, that even the world couldn't help but recognize your work. We know that the work of your hands is unmistakable. Right now, Lord, we also thank you for your word. We're grateful for it and pray that you would open it to us today. We give you thanks, praise, and glory. In the name of Jesus, we pray. Amen. Well, if you have your Bibles with you this morning, you can turn to the book of 2 Samuel. We're going to be in 2 Samuel chapter 11, beginning in verse 1. I'm going to invite you to stand as we read from God's Word, an acknowledgement of what it is. Again, that is 2 Samuel chapter 11, beginning in verse 1. I'll be reading from the New International Version. This is what the Word of God says. In the spring, at the time when kings go off to war, David sent Joab out with the king's men and the whole Israelite army. They destroyed the Ammonites and besieged Rabbah, but David remained in Jerusalem. One evening, David got up from his bed and walked around on the roof of the palace. From the roof, he saw a woman bathing. The woman was beautiful, and David sent someone to find out about her. The man said, "Isn't this Bathsheba, the daughter of Elihim, the wife of Uriah the Hittite?" Then David sent messengers to get her. She came to him, and he slept with her. She had purified herself from her uncleanness. Then she went back home. The woman conceived and sent word to David saying, "I am pregnant." And may God add a blessing to the reading of his word. You can have a seat. Well, we're starting a new series this morning called Core 53. No, that's not true. That's not true. If you're visiting with us, we just did a 52-week series that was, you know, quite long. It was around 52 weeks. And we just came to an end of that. Actually, what we're doing this morning is just kind of an in-between. We're going to be starting a new series next week where we're going to be working through the book of Hebrews. You might remember when Jeff was here, he thought that's what we were doing. And when I heard that, I was like, that's a good idea. Maybe that's what we'll do. No, I knew before then, but it just kind of fits. So this morning, we're actually going to be just kind of spending a little bit of time together on in-between. And I hope that you'll hang with me as we think about this passage of scripture in 2 Samuel. Two men were fishing in a stream when they noticed that a nearby bridge was falling apart. And every time a vehicle would drive across it, another piece would fall and the entire bridge would shake dangerously. Finally, after a large truck passed over, the bridge completely fell apart in the middle. And the two fishermen knew that if a car came around the bend, the driver would never know that the middle of the bridge was gone. And that the whole thing would come crashing down, and damaging the vehicle and injuring the driver would be the best case scenario. So one of the men looked at his friend and he said, "We've got to do something. What would be the Christian thing to do?" And his friend thought for a moment and said, "Build a hospital?" Now, that seems like a bit of a strange response. But it does seem that in the church sometimes, that Christians would rather build a hospital than to put up a warning sign. We tend to deal with things after the fact instead of taking preventative action. We often allow a person to come to a very bad state before we get involved. We can somewhat be afraid of Accountability. God told the prophet Jeremiah in Jeremiah 17:9 that the heart is deceitful above all things and beyond cure. Who can understand it? And our ability to embed ourselves within the impenetrable shell of rationalization, of projection, and denial is nothing short of amazing. Neil Plantega writes, "We deny, suppress, or minimize what we know to be true. And we assert, adorn, and elevate what we know to be false." I love this word. He says, "We prettify ugly realities and sell ourselves the prettified versions. Thus, a liar might transform, 'I tell a lot of lies to shore up my pride,' to, 'Occasionally I finesse the truth in order to spare other people's feelings.'" There's an entire field of psychology, the study of cognitive dissonance, which is based on our limitless ability to rationalize the things that we say and do. And that being the case, we all need people to help protect ourselves from ourselves. That's what accountability is for. It's not necessarily, or in any way primarily, to protect ourselves from others or to protect ourselves from the world. It is to protect ourselves from ourselves and from the desires that live in our own hearts. Accountability is sometimes a scary word in the church. But accountability is not as much about healing as it is prevention. See, the tragedy of King David underscores what can happen when leaders fail to create a structure in which they are answerable for how they spend both their private and professional time. Ultimately, as he did with David, God will hold everyone, all of us, accountable. But the Bible shows us the dangers of living our lives free of accountability. We go back to our text. It starts out saying, "In the spring, at the time when kings go off to war, David, who is the king, sent Joab with the king's men in the whole Israelite army." Now, he's a leader in the army, Joab. He's a leader of David's army. But notice it highlights where David ought to have been. He should have been out there. And he finds himself walking around on the roof at night. He's not drained enough for sleep. He's bored. He's walking around. And sin finds him in his idleness. He sees Bathsheba. He calls for her. And make no mistake, as if Bathsheba just like, oh, like she kind of falls in with this too. And she goes, when the king calls, you go. There's no option. He sleeps with her and she becomes pregnant. By this time, David is around 50 years old. He's been king for about 20 years. He's a gifted musician. He's a mighty warrior. He's a capable leader. He's enjoyed an intimate walk with God. He has a healthy family, a stable political position, and an unbroken string of military victories. David was the king who had it all. He had life by the tail. But one thing he did not have was Uriah's wife. And at that moment, that's what he wanted. One somewhat tragic factor that often gets overlooked in this story is that Uriah is not just like a faceless soldier in David's army. It's not like, oh, well, the only reason that David knows the name Uriah is because he took his wife. Uriah, if you look in 2 Samuel 23, you'll find out, was one of David's mighty men. You know the mighty men of David? Uriah's one of them. Like, David's not like, oh, Uriah, who is that? He knows Uriah. He had a relationship with Uriah. See, here's the thing. Most people don't experience a sudden blowout in their lives. Like where everything was just rolling along great and then all of a sudden it all falls to pot. It's usually a slow leak that ends up leading to disaster. To use a phrase of author Derek Kidner, he says, we deceive ourselves by the smallest of surrenders. We deceive ourselves by the smallest of our surrenders. In other words, a man can deceive himself into thinking that a small compromise won't matter. But small steps taken consistently add up to a great distance. Small compromise has a snowball effect. Momentum develops, and before we realize what's happening, it spins out of control. See, David didn't just wake up one morning, or rather one evening, and decide to trash his life by committing adultery with one of his mighty men's wives and then having that man killed. David had already begun the descent into spiritual sloth by making small compromises. He began by putting his wife, Michal, away, by taking an additional wife, and then another, and another, and another. Eventually, David had 7 wives in all. I can't even imagine. One's plenty. Amen, guys? That was a test. You shouldn't have said anything there. And I didn't mean it. In case Janelle's watching later, she's not going to watch. No, I'm just kidding. But if that wasn't enough, he also stalked a harem. David had this slow leak of self-control. And he compounded that problem by not having anyone around him who would tell him that he had a problem. I want you to note that David didn't have somebody at this point in his life who would take him aside and say, hey, this is not looking right. Now, while the rest of his army was at war, where he should have been, he stayed home. Apparently, again, nobody dared question the wisdom of his hiatus. Nobody to answer to. And so then he breaks 3 of the 10 commandments by coveting his neighbor's wife, committing the acts of adultery, and then murder. And they say you really can't break any of the commandments till after you've broken the first 2. So that's half of them if you're counting. As the details of David's affair unfold, we can't help but wince. David looks. David wants. David takes. David tries to cover up the consequences. David thinks he's gotten away with it. But then we come to the most important verse in the chapter, verse 27. But the thing David had done displeased the Lord. While David could hide his sins from his associates, he couldn't hide them from God. And that's a little detail that we often forget. The Bible assures us in Numbers 32 that your sin will find you out. God sees what is done in the secret place, Psalm 90. Nothing is hidden from Him. Nothing escapes His notice, Jeremiah 23. God may be slow to anger, but He does anger. One day, after all this, the Lord sent the prophet Nathan to confront David. And the king discovered that even kings are accountable for their actions. This happens in the next chapter. Nathan is sent to David, and he tells him a story about a town where there's 2 men who live side by side, a rich man and a poor man. And the rich man had flocks of sheep, and the poor man had one. He had this one little lamb, and he loved it so much that he loved it not just like a pet, the text says he loved it like a daughter. And when the rich man had someone coming over to his house that he wanted to impress, instead of cutting from his own flock, he said, go and take the lamb away from that poor man. And they take the lamb away from him, they slaughter it for the feast. And David is so wrapped up in himself, he's so in his own mind that when he hears the story, He's enraged by this injustice and says, the man who did that, who would do something like that, the man who did that deserves to die. And Nathan says to him, you are that man. You're the king. You've got more wives than you know what to do with. And you took Urias. And then you killed him. When David was confronted with his sin, he had two options: confession or denial. He will either be a man after God's own heart, or he will go the catastrophic way of King Saul. And being a man after God's own heart doesn't mean that we're flawless in our performance, clearly. Being a godly person does not require us to practice sinless perfection. But it does require us to be honest about our failures. David heard Nathan pronounce judgment from God. And he replies with six short words, I have sinned against the Lord. It's not long before we find David composing Psalm 51, a psalm of confession. In this psalm, David pours out his heart. As if you're in Psalm 51, verse 1, he says, have mercy on me, O God, according to your unfailing love, according to your great compassion, blot out my transgressions, wash away all my iniquity, and cleanse me from sin. For I know my transgressions. My sin is always before me. Against you and you only I have sinned and done what is evil in your sight. Skip to verse 16. You do not delight in sacrifice, or I would bring it. You do not take pleasure in burnt offerings. The sacrifices of God are a broken spirit, a broken and contrite heart. O God, you will not despise. David knew that there was no sacrifice that would cover all these presumptuous sins of murder, covetousness, and adultery. David knew there was nothing left to do but to throw himself at the mercy of God. The confrontation of a man of God leads David back into the arms of God. Dietrich Bonhoeffer wrote, nothing can be more cruel than the leniency which abandons others to their sin. I'm going to say that again. Again, this is Dietrich Bonhoeffer. He says, nothing can be more cruel than the leniency which abandons others to their sin. Nothing can be more compassionate than the severe reprimand which calls another Christian into one's community back from the path of sin. You might remember Jonathan, the son of Saul, had been a friend to David. He had provided David with comfort and protection. And there was a tremendous bond between these two young men. Now Nathan cared enough for David to counsel or to rebuke him when it was necessary. And both types of relationships are necessary for you and I. If David had invited Nathan into his life, perhaps Nathan could have given David advice rather than a reprimand. Bonhoeffer continues, when another Christian falls into obvious sin, an admonition is imperative because God's word demands it. The practice of discipline in the community of faith begins with friends who are close to one another. And words of admonition and reproach must be risked. I've told you this before. And I say it again because I think we all need it. I have people in my life who I have specifically invited to please watch me, to please judge me. If I am out of step to take me aside, even when I don't want to be taken aside, to remind me of this deal, to say, you think you're this, but really you're this. You think you're acting this way, but here's how it's coming across. To come to me with the open word of God and correct me when I need to be corrected. Who I've invited to ask me questions about my devotional life, to ask me questions about my family life, to ask me questions about my marriage, to ask me questions about my eyes and my hands and my feet. And there's no lying. If we're not intentional about inviting someone like Nathan into our lives, then usually God will provide a Nathan for us, but by then it may be too late to spare us from the consequences. Loved ones, wise people don't wait for a crisis to establish accountability. Accountability relationships can't be imposed. They have to be invited. The onus is on you. The onus is on leaders in the Bible to establish structures and relationships that harness their sin and unleash their potential. We need to seek out godly people of mature character and then give them permission to ask us tough questions. And I know what you're thinking. Sounds like a lot of fun. It takes risk on our part. It requires honesty and vulnerability. Risky things that we're often skittish about. However, as anyone who has ever suffered the consequences of a fall will tell you, an ounce of prevention is worth a pound of cure. Deception, particularly self-deception, never leads to liberation. It leads to subjugation. You don't become free, you become a slave. Our ability to deceive ourselves is virtually boundless. And that's why accountability is so necessary. I've said to you, it is strictly the human condition where we can be both the author and the believer of a lie. And without submitting to the counsel of others, we can rationalize almost anything. So yeah, I'm doing this thing, but the only reason is, or I have to because... And it's especially true if what we're doing involves a small series of compromises. Accountability is needed not so much to protect us again from others, but to protect us from ourselves. Those who say that they are accountable only to God, have you ever heard somebody say that? Well, I answer to the Lord. They fail to realize the spheres of human authority that God has established for your own good. I believe there is actually a desire for the freedom that comes from confession. The Bible commands us to confess our sins to one another. But it's scary, so we don't do it. In his book, The Man in the Mirror, Patrick Morley writes an open letter to men and their pastors. And this really struck me. Here's what the letter says. Dear pastor, you know me well. I sit toward the front of the church every Sunday. I'm always there. On the way out, I always greet you with a handshake and a smile. And you seem to be glad to see me too. But you don't know the real me very well. Behind my happy smile is a life that is somehow unbalanced. Occasionally, you have asked me how I'm doing. And I've told you, I'm fine. How are you? I've learned the easiest way to keep to myself is to refocus the attention back on the other person. The truth is, I'm not sure if you really want an answer. I know you deal with a lot of real pain and a real lot of suffering. People losing jobs, their homes, their families, loved ones. Frankly, I'm a little embarrassed to talk to you about where I am spiritually. I'm supposed to be on top of things. After all, I'm a successful businessman. I've tried to take a look at my life to examine my ways. But the plain truth is, I don't know how. I really enjoy your sermons. They move my emotions and my spirit. But on Monday morning at 9 a.m., when the phone starts ringing and the customers start complaining, I can't seem to make the transition. I really need help. Somehow I sense that my problems are really spiritual problems, but I can't find spiritual answers. I know that my marriage looks like a picture of success, but behind the closed doors of my private castle, life is very different. And I would be ashamed for you to know. My children don't seem to like to spend time with me anymore. Frankly, I've shut them out of my life for so long, I really can't blame them. I've wasted more nights in empty motel rooms than I care to remember. At first, I thought I was doing it for my family, to provide them a better standard of living. Now I realize I was really doing it for me. My own personal self-gratification. Maybe I thought it would make me feel more significant. Anyway, I got the ends and the means mixed up. And now I really don't think that they like me very much anymore. I know lots of people, but I'm really a very lonely man. I wouldn't know who to talk to if I could put my frustrations into words. There is no accountability in my life whatsoever. Nobody knows or even seems to care how I'm doing financially, with my business, with my wife, with my children, or spiritually. I know you are interested at the group level, but I'm just talking about me, personally, individually. I don't expect you to personally to spend time with me, but I wish we had some way of linking men together to talk about these things. I think it would happen if you really got behind the idea. Frankly, I've done some things in business which I regret. I've cut corners. I've compromised my integrity. I feel guilty about it. But since nobody knows the difference, I just go on pretending everything is okay. I'm really not much different from anyone else. I often wonder if behind those plastic Sunday morning smiles, if other men might feel the same way that I do. Oh well, I never planned on mailing this letter anyway, but I just had to get some things off my chest. I really wish I could tell you about these things. There's so much I want to know, and I need someone to talk to. Oh well, I guess I'll see you on Sunday. Sincerely, Frank. You know, we'll never know how many men compose letters like this one, but never send them. Nobody wants to go through life like that. Nobody gets married thinking, well, one day my wife and I are, going to feel like complete strangers. Nobody starts a new job and wonders, how long before I start compromising my ethics? Nobody wants to waste more nights in empty motel rooms than they can care to remember. Nobody wants to just pretend that everything is okay. It just happens. Sometimes it seems life just kind of works out that way. And here's at least one reason why. It's because we don't intentionally seek out people who can and will tell us the truth. It's because we don't intentionally seek out people and give them both the permission and the instruction to ask us tough questions. These relationships are not always easy to cultivate. They require intentionality. They require time, trust, and vulnerability. But the cost-benefit analysis shows that this is one investment that really none of us can afford to pass up on. And so today, what I want us to think about is our relationship with Jesus and whether or not we're open to that kind of accountability, that we would deeply search our hearts as to what we might need that accountability for. Sometimes what you and I need is what I call just another person with skin on. It breaks my heart that I can keep promises to a person that I can't keep to Jesus. But I know myself well enough to make sure that I have the person in my life to ask me the questions so that I can keep it to both. It's kind of like this. The teacher can tell you to study questions 1 through 8. And you might do it and you might not. But if there's a test on Thursday and you're going to be accountable to know the information, you're probably going to be more likely to study questions 1 through 8. And so if you know that you've got a struggle in your life, yeah, the one you're thinking about, you can ask the Lord and He'll give you strength. You say, Lord, I don't want to be in this stupid pit. I need you to help me not do this thing or to do a thing I've been putting off. I know I need to do this, but I'm not doing it. And He'll give you the conviction. He'll give you the help. But I tell you what, if you go to that spiritual friend and say, I struggle with this, and next week I want you to ask me about it. When you know that you've got the tough conversation coming, it's just an aid that I need. I think you need it too. And I think we all do. Look, the Lord has given us the gift of His Holy Spirit. He's given us the strength, and you can beat it. But why not take advantage of godly friends? Why not take advantage of the tools that He's given you? In order to help us live lives that are upright, that are pleasing to the Lord. We all struggle with sin. We all want to beat it. And if this is a way to help do it, why would we not take advantage of this? Again, loved ones, it's a way to, in part to celebrate your forgiveness, that you've got victory over it. We celebrate every week that the Lord is taking care of your sin. Romans chapter 6 says, so should we just keep on sinning so that grace may increase? He says, by no means. We died to sin. How could we stand to live in it any longer? We're reminded of Jesus on the cross, His broken body, His spilled blood. And so even as we celebrate this communion in celebration of what the Lord has done, let's be reminded that when we celebrate communion, we're not just acknowledging the right relationship that we have with the Lord because of what He's done. In fellowship, we're also recognizing the right standing that we have with one another. So let's take advantage of that this morning and in the days ahead. We read on the night that our Lord Jesus was betrayed that He took bread. He gave it to His disciples and He gave thanks for it. And following that example, we're going to give thanks for the bread. Our great God and Heavenly Father, we once again acknowledge Your goodness. We are grateful before You for this bread and for the way that we can share it with one another. We ask You to bless it now. In Jesus' name, amen. Jesus took the bread and He said, "This is My body, which is for you. Do this as often as you do it in remembrance of Me." Likewise, after supper, Jesus took the cup, he gave it to his disciples, and he gave thanks for it. And following that example, we're going to give thanks for the cup. Heavenly Father, we are once again reminded that without the spilling of blood, there is no forgiveness for sins. We are grateful before you this morning for this cup and everything it means to us. We return thanks to you in Jesus' name. Amen. Jesus took the cup and he said, "This is the new covenant in my blood, which is spilled for many for the remission of sins. Do this as often as you do it in remembrance of me. For as often as you eat this bread and drink this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes." As we close this morning, we're going to acknowledge the Lord for who he is and sing together, "Jesus Messiah." I'm going to invite you to stand as we sing.
Righteousness. He humbled himself and he carried the cross. Love so amazing. Love so amazing. Jesus Messiah. Name above all. Messiah, name above all names, blessed Redeemer, Emmanuel, the rescue for sin. Blessed Redeemer, Emmanuel,
light of the world,
the rescue for sinners, the ransom from heaven, Jesus Messiah, the Lord of all. Messiah, Lord of all, the Lord of all, the Lord of all.
pray together. Heavenly Father, we again acknowledge that you are our Savior. You are our only hope. And yet, Lord, you've blessed us in abundance. And we thank you for the godly men and women that you've brought into our lives. We know they're out there. We know they exist, Lord. And I pray that if we're falling into the snare of sin, that you'd convict our hearts as we desire to live lives for you. That you'd help us to have those difficult conversations and invite people in our lives to ask us tough questions if that's what we need, Lord. Most of all today, Lord, we're grateful for Jesus. We're grateful for the cross. We're grateful for the blood of the Lamb that covers us from sin. Thank you, Lord, for the forgiveness we have in you. To you be all praise, glory, and honor. In Jesus' name, amen. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine on you and be gracious to you. The Lord turn his face towards you and give you peace. Amen.
Jesus Messiah, name above all names, blessed Redeemer, Emmanuel, the rescue for sin. Jesus Messiah, Lord of all.
Good. No shooting arrows, no guitar. So.
Perfect. That's a great life.
Great enough, that's mine.
Yeah.